white funeral pall is placed over the casket is a reminder that in holy baptism, the believer in Christ is clothed in the white robe of Jesus' righteousness that covered all her sins. The purple banding forms a cross, and at its center is a lamb. This reminds us that Jesus is the sacrificial Lamb of God, who on the cross took away the sins of the world, completed the work of salvation, and won eternal life in heaven for the baptized believer. These are they who have come, washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God, Revelation 7. And the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. 1 John 1. Please rise. Faith Lutheran in Dayton, New Jersey, and became a child of God. Joanne was confirmed in her confession of Jesus as her Savior here at Peace on May 5th, 2005, and received for the first of many times the precious gift of our Lord's life-giving body and blood. God bless Joanne, enabling her to serve God, family, and neighbor in her vocations at home, in the workplace, and her community, and at church, thinking of the VBS years especially. On this past Thursday, God blessed Joanne with a holy death and took her home to rest in the arms of Jesus and to await the resurrection of her body. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We give thanks to God our Father through Jesus Christ, our Lord, for this beloved Christian daughter and sister, Joanne Gregory.
I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace.
Let us pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that you called Joanne to the knowledge of your dear Son. You kept her in true faith and granted her a blessed end. We implore you, help us by your Holy Spirit rightly to know and lament our sins, and to be so strengthened in our faith in Christ, that in all things we may grow up into him who is our head, evermore praising you in newness of life, and cheerfully awaiting the glorious appearance of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. First reading is from Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you, but I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, but as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God, how vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they are more than the sand. I awake, and I am still with you. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from Romans 10, beginning at verse 6, and this includes Joanne's confirmation verse, 10, 9 to 10, which you see printed on the front of your bulletin. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down? Or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead? But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is, the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the name of the Lord, for the same Lord, is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus Christ is the firstborn of the dead. To him be glory and power forever. Please rise up under Christ in hearing of his holy gospel. Holy gospel according to Mark chapter 5. Glory to you, O Lord. And this Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little girl is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with them and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You be seated as we sing the beautiful singing of our true self.
Thank you.
Barb, Maverick, Brianna, all Joanne's family and friends, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and from the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Amen. When Joanne went with our church group to the Higher Faith Youth Conference at the Grand Rapids in 2009, she had a new cell phone. We stayed a day after the conference to go to the beach on Lake Michigan, and as the kids waded into the water, Joanne dropped her new phone in the lake. The phone was recovered, but Joanne was worried to tell her parents what happened. Imagine Joanne's relief when she called, I think she called you, Butch, probably borrowing another kid's phone, and you didn't get upset. In fact, you anticipated that just such an accident could happen, and so you had the phone insured. Joanne was so relieved. You were watching out for your little girl, even though she was by then newly graduated from high school. And that, for me, is a window into this Gregory family. That is the kind of parents you are, both of you, Butch and Barb. You do anything you can to help your kids. Not that you pamper them. From what I know, they are all industrious, hard workers, now caring and giving adults. But you as parents, guide them. You come alongside them to face the obstacles and the troubles of life. You are a close family who deeply care for each other. You've got one another's back, as they say. You would not hesitate to go the extra mile for each other. So you, of all families, can understand the choice of Bible text for today. It is Jesus raising Jairus' daughter from the dead. But before I get to that, I want to point out what is going on with this family. We don't know for sure why this young child, we don't even know her name, 12 years old, why she is sicker and dying. Is she born with a birth condition, and therefore does she suffer all these 12 years, only now her health worsens? Or does she contract a disease that baffles the doctors and that baffles her parents? Or does she just suddenly fall ill to stand now at death's door? We don't know. But we do know this is a close family. It is a big thing for a synagogue ruler, local church leader, the father of this dying child. It is a big thing for him to humble himself and go begging on his knees for Jesus' help. Because this dad is used to being in control, but being in control in a good way. He can fix things. He can make things better for his little girl. But now he's stopped. He is up against something he cannot solve, if he could. He would move the world to save his daughter. And then it strikes him. He heard about this man who recently gained a reputation for miraculous cures. This father wastes not a moment. He hurries to Jesus, and we read, he fell at his feet. He implored him earnestly, saying, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well. And then, now you may have noticed our text from Mark chapter 4, as you look at listed there in the bulletin, you can see that some verses are skipped. This is one of those times in the Bible where Jesus is so busy helping people. This father's request for his daughter, it is interrupted. It's interrupted by another miraculous event. A woman in the crowd that is all around Jesus, she touches him. Power goes out from Jesus. And another daughter of Israel is healed of a decade-long chronic disease. Meanwhile, this delay interferes with Jairus' request to heal his daughter. Messengers come and tell Jairus, don't bother the teacher, don't bother Jesus anymore. Your daughter is dead. One has to wonder, why does Jesus let himself get delayed? Doesn't he know the urgency of the girl's need and the pain and the anxiety of the girl's parents? Why does he let her die? Sad, angry, hurt, confused. Jairus and his wife probably, like any of us would, feel all these things. Sad, angry, hurt, confused. But Jesus calms them. Do not fear, only believe. The Lord continues on then to Jairus' house, and right on the heels of his reassuring words to the parents, he says something that almost seems offensive, or at least insensitive, to this crowd of mourners around the little girl's motionless body. He says, why are you making such a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. Our text says they laughed at Jesus. I wonder if some also shot sidelong glances of disgust his way. But Jesus immediately enters this little girl's room with only three disciples and with only the parents. This is a private moment. This is not for show. Jesus senses the pain. He understands the hurt. He takes the little girl by the hand in defiance of religious uncleanness by touching a corpse, and he commands, little girl, I say to you, arise. Instantly, she sits up. She gets up and walks around, and Jesus tells them to give her some food. That means all is back to normal. But please understand what back to normal means. This little girl is revived. She's made alive. But she won't have to die again. For the wages of sin is death. That cure is temporary. But the gift is given. The gift is given to the family. The gift that is besides more time with their daughter here on earth. And the gift is this. A foretaste of the feast to come. A preview of the resurrection of the dead on the last day. For the free gift of God is eternal life through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 6. A short temporary reunion with their revived daughter now, but to guide this family and to guide all families of the earth for the hope of a permanent reunion with their daughters, with their sons, and with all who are miraculously touched by Jesus and told, rise. But in Mark, Jairus has Jesus come to his house. Make all things well for their own. Please don't forget that you brought your little daughter. You brought her to Jesus' house when she was 17 days old. Have our Savior take her by the hand. She did it in her baptism. Took her by her hand into his own death on the cross for her sins. And in her baptism, Jesus took Joanne's hand, and he took her into his resurrection for the death of her eternal death, to give her permanent, everlasting life in heaven. As caring parents, you didn't stop bringing your little girl to Jesus' house for him to take her by the hand. You brought her to Sunday school, where she was taught very likely this same Bible story or others like it. to grow her faith in Jesus, who permanently heals our diseases, who forgives our sins, who will raise our bodies. And you brought your little girl to Jesus and his house when you brought her here for confirmation classes, so that, as her confirmation verse says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart you believe and are justified, and with your mouth you confess and are saved. When Joanne went on that church youth trip to Grand Rapids, at the end of the conference, and I can remember reflecting on this with several other people, I don't know. Joanne sang older at the end of that conference than at the start, the hymns of the divine services that we were attending. And one of those hymns, I am thankful the family chose to sing today. It's the one that we're going to end with here on the board. And I apologize for everyone gathered here today. This hymn is a little hard to sing at first. But eventually it became a favorite of our congregation. The music, once mastered, is majestic, but the message is the best thing of all. And I'd like to conclude with quoting two verses out of it now, because as you're struggling to sing it, it may be hard to concentrate on the words a little later. So I want to quote two of those verses now, so you have the opportunity this time to be comforted by these truths. I want to quote verse 3 for the hope we have for Joanne, and verse 4 for the hope that we all have. You, Christ, our King of glory, the everlasting Son, that you with boundless love sought to rescue everyone. You laid aside your glory, were born of virgin's womb, were crucified for us and were placed into a tomb. Then by your resurrection you won for us reprieve. You opened heaven's kingdom to all who believe. That's verse 3. You, Christ, sit in splendid glory, enthroned at God's right hand, upholding earth and heaven by forces you command. We know that you will come as our judge that final day, so help your servants you have redeemed by blood, we pray. May we with saints, with Joanne and all others who have gone before us in faith, may we with saints be numbered where praises never end, in glory everlasting. Amen, O Lord. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which far surpasses all our human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in true faith, a life everlasting. Amen. As the congregation can now please rise and again have your service folders in the hand. Following each of these petitions, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion. In the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the gate of death and the grave, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, your Holy Spirit, that he may lead us in all holiness and righteousness all our days. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to the bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and a certain hope, in the communion of your church, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love who have departed in faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe in and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, who sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light, we give you thanks that by his death he destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because Jesus lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We pray as Jesus taught us to say, till he comes again in glory. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, merciful Father, look graciously upon us who sorrow at the loss of your land. Teach us, O Lord, ever to remember that your thoughts are higher than our thoughts, and your ways higher than our ways, and that in all things you work for the good of those who love you. Help us call to mind the many mercies which Joanne received from you from her earliest days. We thank you for receiving her as your own dear child with holy baptism, comforting her with the forgiveness of sins in Christ, guiding her feet in the paths of your righteousness, and finally calling her to the joy of your presence. Comfort us with the assurance that you will raise in power and glory the body we now commend to you, even as we trust her soul is with you now. In Jesus we pray. Amen. You see, as we sing now, thank you.
Thank you.
him who is able to keep you from falling, to him who is able to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to the Father and the Holy Spirit, to him be all glory, majesty, power, and authority, now and into all ages of ages. Amen. And please remain seated as a Maverick now has some worship he wants to share with us.
Forgive me and be patient. My sister's favorite flower was sunflower. In life, my sister, the sunflower is very special. I can't think of a more perfect embodiment of my sister than that. Sunflowers are special because they are believed to soak up radiation and heavy metals and fall atoms. Ever since my sister's passing, people reached out and told me about how she would help them through hard times, and she was so caring and loving that she would feel everything so deeply, it was way heavy on her. She helped to make others feel better, even when she didn't. I remember one time when I was a junior in high school, I rolled my truck. And even though I was okay, when my sister heard about it, she drove home the whole two hours crying and climbing in bed with me at 2 a.m. And she was just sobbing, and her response was, "Why are you waking me up right now? I'm trying to sleep." And in the morning, she was still laying next to me. She cried and fell asleep. She drove me crazy a lot of the time. She was wonderful at it. Even though my sister would get overwhelmed by the weight of the world, even like a sunflower, even when it droops, it's still a sunflower. It's still beautiful. She's still radiant with love and light. Everywhere she went, she always brought sunshine and happiness to everybody. And just like sunflower, all of the sun in the sky, she would always look for the best in every situation, and she always looked for the best in people, even when sometimes they would let her down and hurt. She always loved so deep and cared so much still, and everybody would stop her from loving. People would often describe us as twins, and that's what I feel like, is that I lost my other half. There's a lot of myths in the business. They say that it's half the whole, and I feel like I lost my other half. I would be the somber, more stern one, and she was the loving, bright one, the free spirit. She was the one who always felt it so deeply. When my father had his knee surgery, she was the one who was next to his bed, crying, caring for him, while I took care of him. She was the one who always made sure I looked nice before we went to things. And I always had her arm at funerals or weddings because she knew I was a rock. And she was the one who would let everyone know that we cared. We both suffered from depression, and whenever one of us was doing bad, we'd always try to carry the other. And in fact, I had to move her so many times. But there's one thing I thought this whole experience is that I would move her a million more times with one more hug. Move her every day of life. And in fact, today I had a memory of when we used to go to the pool. And we'd play a game where we'd guess the color and she'd dunk me underwater. It wasn't a very fun game for me. And I think she kept changing the color on purpose. But I never felt scared, even though I didn't know how to swim, because she had me in her arms. And that first breath of air, the first thing I'd see every time I came up was her. I knew I'd be okay, because she always had my back. But the one thing everyone can take away from this is that you gotta live in the moment, because you can go every time. And like my sister, everyone should love deeply and freely, and make sure to tell everyone that we see it and then love them, because you never know.
Thank you for those beautiful words. and we just kneel over the Lincoln Club.